forests surrounding the biathlon centre that we're in now. The terrain today, again, is a south-facing slope, in parts steeper than yesterday's mixed sprint. Visibility is very good and the tracks have been well prepared. But again, as we've come to the end of several quite warm and sunny days, what's this done to the skiing? What's this done to the skiing tracks out there in the forest, Marku?
The tracks today will be a bit harder, a bit icier than yesterday, and thus the being skied will be faster. And this, of course, makes it physically slightly easier, but when the skiing speed goes up, then you have to be really, really careful on all crossings and on your skiing so that you don't make any orienteering mistakes.
Is it easier to kind of ski off the track when it's this icy, or kind of make a mistake when you're kind of crossing from one track to another?
Yes, it's easier to miss one crossing or one corner, and then you basically might need to turn back, and that takes a lot of time.
Yep, so we're going to turn to the women's race first on this International Women's Day, and this is the map we've got here. Can you talk us through it?
The first part will be quite fast downhill orienteering, and then in rather dense forest with very dense track system. You can see it's quite nice visibility there. And then turning back to more physical end, and the athletes are coming to the stadium first, just before they take the last controls, and then sprint to the finish.
Yeah, and there's some interesting route choice that could cost them just 5 or 10 seconds right at the end. So they can win or lose even on the last few controls. So here we have a little look at the start list. Now, so it's roughly the best skiers, they're going to start last. But who in the early stages could do well?
I think Johanka Simkova from Czech Republic. She's been very seasoned orienteer, and will be one of the leading ones there. And then, of course, also Stefania Corradini, who was running for Italy in sprint relay. And Hanna Hansikova from Czech Republic also did extremely well yesterday after her injury.
But the top group is starting from Tuva Alexandersson, and they are the top 10 ranked in the world who are competing here. And they are drawn randomly in that group, but those are the best skiers we're going to see starting last.
Yes, Tuva Alexandersson will be the absolute favorite for today also. And we will, as she starts as the first one in the red group, among the best skiers, she will be then the beacon for the others try to beat.
Yeah, so it's definitely going to be her time we're looking out for as the one to beat, and then everyone behind her will be trying to catch up. So the skiers have been warming up for the last hour or so, and
basically the orienteers will arrive here about 2 hours, 1.5 hours before, testing skis, as you can see. Skis will make a major impact, as we saw yesterday. Not as much today as yesterday. If you have really a good pair of skis, the profile is right, you will do well.
So is that all in the preparation of the skis, the waxing? What makes a good pair of skis?
The profile, whether it's what's the interaction between the snow and the skis, and it depends on what kind of profile it's. If it's softer, for basically a bit softer snow, and it of course much harder for an icy tracks like today.
Okay, so we've had a few of the women starting off. It's the women's race first. This on this International Women's Day, which is a big national public holiday here in Russia. It's a big family day. Everyone spends it with their family. But happy International Women's Day to you, everyone listening and watching around the world. This is the first starter.
Yes, Elena Taranova from Kyrgyzstan. They are rather new to the sport, but very enthusiastic. And one of the problems in Kyrgyzstan is that it's rather south, and they have snow, and they have very good conditions on the Taishan Mountains, but it's very high up, so all training needs to be done about 2.5 kilometers, and you know how hard that will be.
Yep, high altitude training. So, yep, through the gate. She was given her map 15 seconds before. and the first starter on the sprint.
This is actually the second time ever Kyrgyzstan, Kyrgyzstan is in the World Championships. So training for young Yelena.
Yep, she's only 17, so got a long future if she sticks at the sport, and we hope to see Kyrgyzstan back at lots more World Championships. So they're all starting off at 1 minute intervals, so we can see if any athletes catch each other up. We know they will have made, they've caught at least 1 minute, so we can tell how the athletes are going through the terrain. We'll also have some GPS tracking to show you as well. This is Anna Kaminska, who was racing in the sprint relay, the mixed sprint relay yesterday.
Yes, Poland is also not the strongest nations in ski orienteering, but we know that there are very good skiers in cross-country side, and also good orienteers and mountain bike orienteers, so there is no reason why Poland wouldn't be coming.
Yeah, they can. Once they combine the two, then they will definitely improve. So you can tell that they're taking advantage of just this small stretch out to the start to get a little look at their map. And this is how we're going to have the GPS tracking. So the map is on a bit of a 3D profile with the top of the hill at the top of the map, the north end of the map. And we will have about a 30-second delay on the GPS. So just because of where it's being sent to. So we will see the GPS tracks about 30 seconds later, but it's still a very good indication of what routes they've chosen, and that's really going to be key in the competition, especially at the higher end, whether they can gain or lose some seconds depending on their route choice.
Yes, and there are some legs in the competition where the route choice has to make a major difference and maybe decisive, and we will see it in the end more clearly. And Elmira Moldasheva is from Kazakhstan, and Kazakhstan is the strongest nation in ski orienteering in Asia. And we've got new nations coming up lately from there, and look forward to getting more.
Yes. This is Johanka Simkova, who we could possibly expect to be posting some fast times early on in this competition. The Czech athlete has a ski world ranking of 50, so compared to a lot of the people starting around her who are ranked outside of the top 100, she's going to look to be skiing very well and probably catching up quite a lot of, if not all of the people in front of her, only starting fourth. She was 26th in the sprint at the Europeans in Finland, so she could very well have a good competition.
Yes, and she's done earlier years. She's been among the top 15, top 20 best in World Championships before, and she's very much likely to be the first one in the finish.
Yep, so we'll watch out for her to set some fast times that we can use to compare some of the later starters with. She will be setting the times to beat. Here we look at the fifth starter, Irina Yuruk from Belarus.
She's been in World Championships before, not in the top positions, but is a steady orienteer will be around, if good race is done, about 20-25th position is possible for her.
So here we can see some of the early routes into the forest. Very straight running for the pink athlete, which is Elena Taranova. Possibly cutting through on some of the slower tracks, but I think it's difficult to tell with the GPS which tracks they're on, some of them. But Elena Taranova has got control number one, but being caught up by Moldasheva
from Kazakhstan, yes. And there are basically two route choices to the first control. One going straight, a little bit on the left side, going through smaller and narrower tracks, and then a right route choice through much wider tracks and faster skiing, but it's a little bit longer. I would guess that there is about five to 10 seconds difference between the route choice from the right being slower. So going straight would be the best choice today.
Yes, and because that leg's downhill, you're not going to lose as much time on the smaller tracks, is that right?
Correct. And we will see the athletes choosing wider tracks when they go uphill, because the narrow tracks are, of course, very much slower.
Petra Hankova of the Czech Republic. This is her first World Ski Orienteering Championships, aged 20. She raced. She's raced in JWOC in 2016, coming 12th in the sprint. So her senior debut. She's very hasty to leave the start gate there. We've got to wait 15 seconds to get their map. It gives them a time to get the shape of the course, maybe get the route to, or at least think about the route to number one.
No, it takes most time to put the map in the map holder and then get ready. But the fastest ones will look the first two, three legs from the route and see also the shape of the entire course.
So they can get something before the start time, a little bit.
Yes.
Do they practice a lot putting the maps in the map bag and when they start?
Yes, they do. And especially here in individual time start, it doesn't make that much difference. But when you have many loops in mass start, and then basically you can lose a lot of time with that. Then the first Estonian, Epp Ahlberg, her first World Championships as well.
Yep, she also competed at the Junior Ski World Championships this year as well.
Yes, and one of the more talented young Estonians. Estonia has here a rather young and talented team. And you can already see from the GPS that Johanna Sinkova is very close passing the others.
Yep, she's caught Elena Taranova, the woman who started 3 minutes ahead of her, and is probably soon going to catch Moldasheva as well. So she will soon have clear snow ahead of her. But would that make it hard of her to race if she's going first?
Not today, because today it's rather icy. We are expecting new snow tomorrow, and then it will be a slight disadvantage.
Stefania Corradini of Italy. Now, she raced in the mixed sprint relay yesterday and was looking very, very good, especially on the first leg of the relay. She was in the top few positions coming through. Didn't quite have the stamina to maintain the speed required for that for the whole race, but certainly very impressive at the beginning. So she could be looking to set some fast times early on in this race as well.
Yes, and she's still very young. And second generation ski orienteers on World Championships. His father is world champion, Niccolo Corradini.
So got some good racing blood in her, but one of the younger ones maybe needs to get some more experience on the senior world stage. She is age 20. But this is Asem Nazarova?
Yes, from the Kazakhstani team. And they actually have a quite good... Kazakhstan has quite good team on the relay on Sunday. She's been in World Championships now. I think this is the third time. Third time for her. And now we see already... That is Sinkova.
Yep, that is Sinkova. She's coming through to our first TV split point, and she's gone through the three athletes who we've had gone through the pre-TV control.
Yes.
She's been racing for about six and a half minutes as she makes her way up the hill.
Catching Moldasheva. Chasing her there. This is rather steep. I was in the forest there 2 days ago, and it's the sun shining directly to the snow makes it wet and very, very tough to ski.
Here we go. You can see the difference between the narrower tracks and taking the touch three punching through the control.
Yes.
So after 1.2 kilometres, Moldasheva is the first through our first radio control in just under 8 minutes.
And Antonia Krikorova. It's Andrea Dyaksavo starting there. Again, a young Bulgarian talented girl running for the race. And here, Olga Novikova, among others, junior world champion.
This is Rika Bruns from Germany.
She did quite good laps in the sprint relay yesterday.
Do you think after having run the sprint relay they'll have an advantage or a disadvantage?
It depends. The terrain is totally different, but the terrain type and the type of tracks is exactly the same, so I don't think that there is a disadvantage if you haven't been racing, because if you raced yesterday you've burned a little bit of your energy already. So I think the competitors are rather even, and we can see there in the first TV control, Johan Kasinkova is in the lead now. And you can see the different route choices between Mordasheva and Simkova. To first control.
Yeah, they've taken the decision to go straight up from the hill out of control number one, and we think that's definitely the quickest time at going, keeping slow and having the climb a bit later is going to actually give you more climb overall and be about 10, 15 seconds slower?
Yes, that's true. It looks easier to ski from the right, but at least easier to orienteer from the right. But and Hanna Hanchikova did extremely well in the relay. She broke her leg only 2.5 months ago and has been able to train skiing the past 3 weeks, I think.
So not had even remotely a season of training, and she's here. The best of the Czech women.
Yes.
But now we can see how everyone is grouped together, but it looks like it is
Petra Hanchova who is trying to catch, and she takes the lead now about 20 seconds faster than Johan Kasinkova.
30 seconds faster.
Yes.
See how the start list is beginning to unravel and people setting the fast times.
Correct. And Daisy Kudre from Estonia. She's been doing top six positions in the World Cup races. If she does a steady and good run, she has a chance to be in top 10. And the first Swede.
You can see they're being given their GPS trackers.
Yes.
So we can follow them in the forest and just sit in their little jacket at the back so we can find out where they're going.
Yep. And it's a double Czech lead in the first intermediate time by Petra Hanchova and Johan Kasinkova, when Olga Novikova is now starting. So you can see, you have a little bit of time to take a look on the map, and especially the first leg, because it's very easy that you are too eager and too stressed in the beginning to do mistakes in route choices.
Yeah, many people that I talk to on Fit Orienteering sometimes say if they mess up number one, then the whole of the rest of their race is completely gone and they're not concentrating very much. And people really struggle to get their control number one right because they're not in the flow yet. They're not as used to the terrain or the scale of the map, or they're just a bit nervous maybe. And maybe these women will have a bit more nerves than normal in the World Championship.
Yeah, world champs are like that. And in orienteering also, the second control is bad because you are so focused on getting the first right, then you miss the second. And normally, physically, your body and your mind start to work better after about 4, 5, 6 minutes.
Mm.
then you gain your balance.
Yep, the importance of a good warm-up. This is Epp Palberg, first of the Estonians. She's not going to challenge the leading time of Petra Hankova. So still two Czech athletes in the lead at this first radio control.
And she went into the fourth position, and there you... Okay, here is Stefania Corradini coming now towards the TV control. And she is doing actually a good time, but not taking the lead. There's about 20, 25 seconds to climb that hill to the next control.
And you're saying it's much steeper than this camera angle makes it look.
Yes, yes, it is. It looks very easy, and you wonder why they are going so slow. Please try, try yourself.
So and she working, just looking at the picture there, explain to me, she looks like she's working a lot more with her right pole than she is with her left.
Yeah.
That's, is that just her stronger arm?
No, no. It's basically the way you do. There are kind of different techniques for different different parts of the terrain.
Mm-hmm, different inclines and different steep. Okay. And that's the way she's working. And good technique.
Yes, and then there is Asem Nasarova from Kazakhstan. And she's basically on the same speed as Stefania Corradini and Irina Jurok at this stage. And the same hill, and soon we should see Hanna Hanchikova coming, and I would expect her actually to take the lead, so that there will be then two Czechs on top positions at the first, three Czechs.
Yep, we're expecting her to be punching at our pre-warning control soon, and then we will see her probably 2 minutes later at our, she will be punching our first TV control.
Yep, and faster than her, there is Andrea Dyaksova. She's doing quite well, going to probably take the third position at this point before the best Kazakh orienteer, Elmira Moldasheva. Not quite, but almost.
Yep.
I think Stefania Corradina must have taken made a mistake, because she's now more than a minute behind the leading Petra Hanchova. And
yep, as we can see, she's a minute and 24 seconds down. So we'll see if we can catch up with that later on the GPS. But at the moment, it's two Czechs in the lead. Petra Hankova with 27 seconds over Johanka Simkova.
And at this stage of the competition, among the first starters, the time differences are much bigger. But when we come to the really the favorite ones like Tove Alexandersson here, then you will see that the differences will be much, much smaller. Kristina Kolinova from Czech Republic.
Yep, she has a ski world ranking of 41. But this looks like, it looks like she's fairly new to ski orienteering. I've got this down as being her first World Ski Orienteering Championships, with results only starting to ski world ranking events from 2016. So
now we have already Johanka Simkova coming to the finish, and she will be, as we spoke, the first lady to finish. And as we've seen from the intermediate time, she was doing very well in the beginning. So she's
been out skiing for 16 and a half minutes so far.
So we were expecting actually that the ladies would be a little bit quicker today because of the weather and the snow, but we would think that the quickest ones will be around 14 and a half minutes.
So that's it, just under 17 minutes there for Johan Kasimkova. Is that a good starting point set to beat?
Yes, and it's very good to check how they're doing as we are waiting for Petra Hanchova, who in the second intermediate control was ahead, still ahead of Johan Kasimkova.
Yep, we'll see her. But this is Rika Bruns and Hanna Hanchikova.
And we can see that Hanna Hanchikova is going very fast. She's already passed Rika Bruns there. And she took a second position there. And Olga Novikova has, in the meanwhile, taken the lead with 12 seconds to... 8 seconds to Hanna Hanchikova and 12 seconds to Petra Hanchova. Then we have the first of the Finns starting, Mirka Suutari. And she will be then chased by the reigning world champion, Tove Alexandersson. Tove has actually won three world champs in a row in ski orienteering in sprint. So this is her speciality. And Elvira Moldasheva coming to the finish. And Petra Hanchova behind her. And Hanchova is now taking the lead.
Yep, she's taking the lead on our second radio control. But she's still got just over a minute of skiing, just under a minute of skiing to go. And she can see if she can beat the time of Johan Kasimkova.
She will be probably 20-25 seconds faster than Johan Kasimkova. And here to Alexandersson. She's basically the reigning world champion in foot orienteering as well. And yesterday she was totally crushing against all the other competitors. And to get the gold medal, they had to beat Tove.
Yes, I think that's exactly it. But this is Petra Hanchova in to the finish. Taking a lot of time out of Johan Kasimkova, roughly 45, 46 seconds. That's a really great ski from her in the
and
early stages.
It seems that she's been able to keep her speed all through the race, and I don't think that she's made any big mistakes at all during the course.
And that's exactly the key. It's making the right route choices and making them quickly, so you have no hesitations, you're not losing any seconds, because it could come to that at the end of this race. It could come to just seconds in it.
Yes.
Although if we get a repeat of the Europeans, then it will be Tore Alexandersson with a big lead.
Could be, but it's ski orienteering is kind of funny. If you miss one single crossing, then you might lose a lot of time.
This is Linda Lindqvist,
and she's challenging Olga Novikova's time and will take the lead with a couple of seconds in the first intermediate control.
Yeah, whilst we were focusing on some other people, we had Daisy Kudrey also posting a fast time in third place currently at that TV control.
And we see here Johan Kasimkova, Olga Novikova and Linda Lindqvist in comparison. And now another favorite from Sweden, Magdalena Olsson.
Yep, world-ranked in number fifth place. She was third at the Europeans in Finland, so we'll be looking for another medal to add to her collection.
Yes, and here we have Gabriele Andrausi-Suunione, and she is actually not that much behind Linda Lindqvist, who took the lead just about a minute and a half so. Probably coming to fifth or sixth position at this point. And yet one of the favorites, Maria Kechkina from Russia.
ranked number 2 in the world. She had a collection of podium positions at the European Championships. Second in the middle, third in the long, and fifth in the sprint. So a very good all-round skier.
And she was very good in the Ski Tour in Central Europe this year, winning a few races there. And this has been her best year so far. And then we have
Kristina Kolinova
coming in.
He's also posted a fast time at our pre-warning control. Doesn't look like it's going to be challenging the lead, as we've seen Mirka Sutari and Evina Vesely Anderson. They've also posted quick times at our pre-warning control. So we'll see them soon chasing Kristina up this hill, and they may well have some of the new fastest times. I think it's going to look like it's going to challenge Linda Lindqvist.
And Mario Turunen, strong Finnish ski orienteer. She was in the World Championships in Norway 2015. She was bronze medalist in the middle distance, where Finland took four first places in a sprint race from the last control. And this is the second intermediate time, and it's about 1.5 minutes, and here is a route choice which is really important for the top athletes to get that right. If you take a route choice going up, then you probably win with 5 or 10 seconds with your route choice to the last control. And Polina Frolova, the previous Malchikova, and she's also world champion in middle distance earlier. And Tuve Alexanderson is taking now the lead. A clear lead at this point.
Yep, she's looking to be about 30 seconds ahead of Linda Lindqvist at this, on
and
our pre-warning control.
As well. And she started very strong and absolutely no mistakes. She's already half a minute, 35 seconds lead at this point of the race.
That's
looks,
a big chunk out
strong.
For the first bit. Yeah, looks incredibly strong, and she knew exactly where she was turning into for that control. And it's quite easy to see in this forest. The trees aren't too close together. It's fairly easy to see the controls as well from a far distance if the terrain is in your favour.
Yeah, Milka Reponen from Finland. She's had a tough year this year. Hasn't got her orienteering going well. But she's the reigning world champion from Norway in the middle distance.
Maybe have a point to prove. But this, we can see Tove Alexandersen's lead. It's everyone taking roughly the same route choices, although looks like Linda Lindqvist having a bit of trouble getting out of control number 3. But the lead of Tove Alexandersen is very clear at the moment.
And Tatiana Oborina, who started after Tove Alexandersen, she was also about 35 seconds behind Tove Alexandersen. One of the favorites, Alena Trapechnikova from Russia, and she will be fighting for the medals, I think.
And we'll definitely have the crowd support for her as well, and they head back into, well, almost back into the arena at some point, just before the very end of the course, and they would be able to feed off the crowd there, I'm
yes,
sure.
Yes, and Tatiana Oborina from Russia, who started 1 minute behind Tove Alexandersson, but Tove is clearly going on her own speed. Tatiana is now fighting her place among, she's going now in the fifth place, just before Daisy Kutre from Estonia. A little disappointing start from her side. It looks like Tuve is racing now, her own race, and then the others are relatively close to each other.
Yeah, we've got some news from the finish, and Daisy Kudre has come in and posted the quickest time so far, taking 11 seconds out of Petra Hankova. It's a great time for her. Good race. New time to beat.
New time to beat. And then we have Evelina Wickboom from Sweden starting here. Magdalena Olsson is now taking the second position, but she's also about 30 seconds behind Tove Alexandersson at this stage. So double Swedish lead at the moment. And Daisy Kutre's time actually is a very good race from her, and she will be fighting for a place among 10, 12 bests with that time.
Yeah, that's great news for her. But, of course, she's got a nervous wait as we find everyone else coming in. But some of the GPS tracking there showing the routes of the first part of the course before they head west. And this is our final starter.
Salla Koskela from Finland. And she did good race yesterday, getting bronze medal in sprint relay. And she's been very strong, especially in skiing in this year. So all the ladies out. Marina Kecina taking the second position now, 22 seconds behind Tove Alexandersson. Steady race, but Tove's pace is unless she makes a mistake.
And this is one of the controls. This is the second to last control,
and they do the right choice. You have a route choice there. Either you turn back, you're on your skis, and you go back, or you continue the track to a wider track. And then they come together. However, if you continue, you will lose about 4 or 5 seconds in that route choice. And we have Linda Lindquist now chasing Daisy Kutre's time.
And her time looks very, very good. She's pre-warned almost a minute ahead of, just about a minute ahead of Daisy Kutre. So looking for her to take the new fastest time, and she does.
1 minute faster than Antonia Grigorova. And Marit Turunen coming here to the intermediate control, first intermediate control. And we should soon actually get Tove Alexandersson to the last intermediate control. But this is not Marriott's day. She will be getting now the sixth position at this stage of the race.
But unless we haven't heard Tove Alexandersson through the pre-warning control yet, and she looks like she's... Unless there's something wrong with the control, she's lost some time on Linda Lindquist because she's not come through that control yet. She's been racing for just about 11 minutes.
Yeah.
And Linda Lindquist came through at 10 minutes and 20 seconds.
Yes. Gabriele Andrausiene. And this is the second last control, and she now continued the track to the wider track, and she will lose here about 4 or 5 seconds taking that route choice than just turning your skis and going back. And here Milka Reponen, the next Finnish girl coming to the first intermediate time.
Looks like it's fairly quick from her.
Yes, she's been doing quite well. And will be losing to Polina Frolovaya and Maria Kechkina as well. And now we have Tove.
So this is her at our second radio time, and probably not taking the quickest route there.
No, this is actually the quickest route.
Yeah, you don't want to go completely up the hill.
No.
Because you can turn a very sharp right and go all the way up the hill. But this is Tove Alexandersson into
the second last control
where she can decide to go straight on or turn around. But you can see her GPS data. So it's about 30 seconds behind. She's just punched the final control and heading. This is her punching the second to last control. Oh, and she keeps going. That's 5 seconds. Is it going to be crucial, do we think? We will have to wait and see, I think.
Normally it wouldn't for her, but it appears that she's done a mistake on the second half of the race. and it may be decisive and for medals.
Yes, so our point about the pre-warning control, it didn't come through on our computer. It may have registered in fine, it just may not have come through on our computer. So doesn't seem to be too much of a problem there. So she is challenging some of the times of the top athletes so far.
And she will be soon already here at the finish. She's coming now. Trapechnikova is far behind, and Tove Alexandersson is now coming to finish. And she will definitely take the lead.
But and will it be enough?
Will it be enough? It looks like that she had made a mistake. She hasn't been able to keep the same pace because she was basically 1 minute before Linda Lindqvist in the first intermediate time. And she is again 1 minute ahead of her.
Stopping the watch and checking her time.
Yeah.
Maybe some assessments going
and
there.
And I think she's wondering about the mistake she's done or checking that.
Yeah,
we don't know.
We will have to see as other people challenge her time. But this is Evelina Vikvom, the second to last starter. Looks like she's been caught or has caught someone else.
By Salla Koskela is coming from behind, so she will be not much behind, actually, Tove Alexandersson at that point. She should be coming there very, very soon. And now we have Magdalena Olsson on the second intermediate control. Only two controls left.
Yep, she looks like she's taken the quickest route through the forest there.
Yep.
Going down and up a fairly steep re-entrance and then taking what looks like the fastest route there and down through the forest into the second to last control. And from there, it's only a short, fairly flat track and then a very, very steep uphill to get into the arena. And then obviously pushing for the line. You know exactly where you're going. All you can focus on is speed. And so she, turning, braking and turning the corner, which we think is the quickest route of the two.
Yeah. And Magdalena is actually fighting for the second place at this point because she was in the intermediate controls about 45 seconds behind Tove Alexandersson. And here, Tatiana Oborina. Not the perfect day for her. Yep. Because Linda Lindqvist and Mirka Suutari were very well ahead of her, but fourth position so far. And now it will be interesting to see Magdalena Olsson, whether she can make Mirka Suutari's and Linda Lindqvist's times. And Polina Frolova, no, Maria Kechkina, going to the second last control. And she's also 1 minute behind Tove Alexandersson and fighting for actually medals with Mirka Suutari, Linda Lindqvist at this point. And Maria changes, turns her skis and goes back and wins about 3-4 seconds with that route choice.
But we've just had Magdalena Olsson into the finish to post the second fastest time so far. 43 seconds behind Tove Alexandersson in a time of 14:37.
But here we have Polina Frolova. She's only 10 seconds behind Tove Alexandersson. And we remember that Tove lost 4 or 5 seconds going out from the second last control. So whether that will be silver or gold for Polina Frolova.
Let's keep an eye on that one, the two athletes who were running for the sprint relay.
And the both ones took the same route choice to the second last control, so there is no change. And Maria Kechina is fighting now for the second position, third position, but she can't make it to the top five now. Magdalena Olsson is ahead of her. And now it would be really interesting to see Polina Frolova because she's fighting now for gold. And she should be coming to the last control very, very soon. Polina Frolova should come there any second. And she was only 10 seconds behind Tuve Alexanderson at the second intermediate
here,
control.
Here she is,
and Polina
coming up
is
the
coming
hill.
Now.
She's got 20 seconds to get into the finish.
And no.
Are you going to call it? No.
I'm going to call it.
She's got
15 seconds now, and
10.
That 10 seconds will be the difference. And Salla Koskela is also coming, or is it? No, it's Milka Reponen.
It's Turunen.
Mari Turunen, but she's lost. Polina Frolova is now. She's lost the gold, but fighting now for silver. And very close. Very close. She took those 4 seconds from the intermediate control.
Yeah, she's, well, about 7 seconds both at the intermediate control and at the finish. So
yeah.
Very, very similar time. That was pretty close, but not quite enough for Polina Frolova.
And for the past years, this is actually when Tuve has made error-free races. This is the closest anybody has got so far. And we still have Salla Koskela left there.
Yep, I think Salla Koskela from the earlier times at our first radio control is the one who looks like she could challenge the top for the medals.
And Milka Reponen coming, but she's now 1.5 minutes behind, so no medal for her. But we are waiting for Salla Koskela to come soon. That's Alena Trapechnikova. And she is also 1 minute behind. So it's only Salla Koskela who can now fight for the two first positions.
And the tracks are getting a bit cut up now with the skis. Maybe seeing, you can see a lot where the athletes have gone beforehand, and maybe giving a little clue as to which might be the quickest route. Just follow the tracks. But of course, you know, they're all skiing by themselves. They're all looking very closely at the map.
Yes. And you don't want to make a mistake close to the finish. So
the results,
here the results
stand.
So far.
Tove Alexanderson in just under 12 minutes, quicker than we were expecting. And then we have Polina Frolova just under 8 seconds behind. And we can see as the results keep going, just pushed out of the top 10 for Daisy Kudrey before, and some of the other runners coming in 5-6 minutes and longer behind the winning time, not the winning time, the leading time of Tuve Alexanderson.
Yes, and Milka Reponen coming to the finish, but she was 1.5 minutes behind Tuve Alexanderson.
Yeah, she is already late on Tuve Alexanderson's time, is not going to challenge, and is not even going to challenge for the medals.
No.
Possibly a top 10 finish.
Also, Alena Trapechnikova has lost to Tuve Alexanderson at this stage, and she is soon coming. And it would be very interesting to see Salla Koskela's times, because she was closest to Tuve Alexanderson at the intermediate times.
Yeah,
and
I think it's
fighting
gonna be
for the bronze with Magdalena Olsen.
Yeah, I think it's going to be difficult to challenge the top two times, especially as they were so close. But
yeah.
I think it's 14:37 of Magdalena Olsen we need to watch out for.
Yes, and Alena Trapechnikova, their seventh position today. 1 minute, 5 seconds behind Tuve Alexanderson. And still two more ladies to come.
Yep, we have Salla Koskela and Evelina Vikbom, the last two starters out in the forest.
And
but it's...
They've lost.
Yeah, they're not going to challenge. Let's have a look at the route of Tove Alexanderson, the top three there, and Tove Alexanderson taking what we thought is probably the quickest route,
yes,
to control number one. She's made the route choice very different to the others, and possibly one quicker going through the forest out of control number one.
And you can see here the skiing power of Tove. And you can see also the different route choices that Magdalena Olsson is especially taking.
Yeah, Polina Frolova taking some of the narrower tracks to control number three, not going quite as fast, but not losing as much time.
Salla Koskela coming here. And yes, she took no...
Salla Koskela in third place.
Third place.
Yep. She's taken third ahead of Magdalena Olsson.
And only 18 seconds behind Tove Alexandersson. So
currently, Bernadette Salla Koskela in third for Finland, Polina Frolova in second for Russia, and the win, as yet, needs to be confirmed for Tove Alexandersson with a time of 13:54.
Actually, it was surprising that Polina Frolova and Salla Koskela were actually so close to the Alexandersson, because we didn't see any mistakes done, at least so far, from GPS. And it was, these three were slightly faster and better than the others. And then we had the group of competitors between basically 1 minute and 2 minutes from Tove.
Yes, but the first three, considerable gap to a bigger bunching later on. And here we can see all of the finishes at the end of this women's race.
And here we can see the run at the GPS. Tove taking a slightly different route there, and then her skiing power. She's in the lead during the dense part, uphill part of the race.
And then Polina Frolova takes a slightly different route through to control number three. Tove Alexandersson sticking on the really wide path and getting a lot of power from that.
Yeah.
Fairly similar straight routes into control number five.
And again, that's a route choice actually where Tove took a better route than the others, and she made also a shortcut there.
And then going down
again,
this track,
slightly different
speed.
Route choices, but close by. No, Tove hasn't made any mistakes, but Polina Frolova and Salla Koskela have been able to ski her speed, basically.
Yes.
And
oh, but
here
this is interesting.
We see
she
there
came...
she lost time, going from the left to the third last control.
That
and again, the others turned around there, their skis.
Mm, it was quite narrow going up the track into the third from the last control, and that's where she lost a lot of time. It's definitely less easy to skate. But here are some of the pictures. In third place, Salla Koskela.
And the
no
bronze
mistakes,
medalist.
Really, the bronze medalist. No mistakes particularly, but just not quite the power. Maybe some route choices, not quite as fast as Tove Alexandersson. But Polina Frolova from Russia taking the silver medal.
And the ladies today got exactly the same positions yesterday. So Tove Alexandersson called Polina Frolova silver and Salla Koskela bronze. So they don't need to change the flags for the prize-giving ceremony. And here, Tove Alexandersson, the winner and world champion today.
She will have had a bit of a nervous wait at the end, but in the end, it was all hers. She could take the victory, and it was really great. And I think I think the fact that the winners are from the sprint relay, so it shows that the team managers made the right selections as well. That the fastest ones, they know who the fastest ones are, they know they can put their best teammates out, and it certainly skiing yesterday didn't impact on their ability to ski today. They're used to running rooster skiing many days consecutively, and just make the right recovery and you can go and win another world championships medal.
Exactly. And it was funny in the end, the third last control, the second intermediate control, I would say 95% of people would take the route choice from the right with the wider track. and Tuve, for some reason, took the slower route, a slightly shorter, but much, much lower route.
Do you think that's because of it being right at the end of the course and your kind of concentration is going? You've just skied up the hill into the arena. Do you think that's why it's kind of tricky to get the route choice right at the end?
That might be, but sometimes in ski orienteering, you see after a while in the race, you make your strategy how you're going to run the race. And if Tuve has chosen that this is a good day to go straight, it doesn't make sense to go around and gather meters and meters on the route choices. So she just continues to execute that strategy by going straight, and in this case losing. But in most of the race, the shortest route here was actually the quickest one in these snow conditions and in this terrain.
Yeah, they're going to race. Yeah, but there you can see on that control, Tove Alexandersen coming up there. Maybe she decided she didn't want to go and ski down the big re-entrance, but losing a bit of time, but in the end it didn't really matter. She kept the strategy that she raced the whole time, and it worked the rest of the time. Even if she dropped a few seconds at the end, it didn't make any difference.
And basically, Polina Frolova and Salla Koskela were racing the rest of the race, same speed or even faster than Tuve, the second half.
Yes.
This will be interesting for the middle distance.
It will indeed. So stay tuned for the men's race. Their first starts will be at 3:35 local time, so that is just about 12 minutes time. Have a little break between each of the races, and then the men will set out into the same area, a different course, slightly longer. The women raced for 3 kilometres, probably skiing about just under 4 kilometres, but the men have 3.47 kilometres. They'll be going a bit further, but again with an estimated winning time of between 15 and 30.
No, 12 and 15 minutes.
12 and 15 minutes. Thank you. So stay tuned for that race of the men's.
Чемпион Сейчас мы начнем с первого по шестое место. Традиционно будет сюда. Начало, начало, начало.
So now we turn to the men's race, the second race today on the sprint day here in Krasnoyarsk at the biathlon centre, where there is a bit of a crowd, probably mostly Russians, but we're suspecting International Women's Day may have a factor on the crowd size. If people are, it's a big family day, especially in Russia, and people may be choosing to spend the day with their families. But happy International Women's Day to everybody. Here we can see the conditions, air temperature of +5 degrees, making it slippery and fast out there. There's a little bit of wind, a bit of a cold wind. We can see the athletes warming up in lots of layers in front of us. But no chance of any snow today. Beautiful blue skies in this biathlon centre, which you can see just the finish straight in front of there. Now this is the men's course.
It's very similar to ladies' course. Men are actually skiing a little bit longer, about 1 kilometer, a half a kilometer longer, and taking much, much more climbing in the race. And the radio controls are the 7th control and the 12th control in the race, the same positions as for ladies' races. And pretty much the same applies for men's race as for women. You have to ski fast and not make very many mistakes in the race. If, for instance, the ladies' three best would have done one single missing route choice or missed a crossing, the color of their medals would have been changing.
Yeah, it was very tight. And here we can see the start list for the men. We have, they're going off in the order, roughly in the order of the best place, the best in the world rankings are going off last. And can you pick out some names who we're going to watch out for?
Men's race will be quite even, but of course the red group in the end, the last 20 athletes will be the ones fighting most for the medals. We have 55 starters, and the early starters, for instance, Øyvind Wiggen from Norway and Bjørnar Kvåle, will be those who will set the pace for the race. And here we see the teams preparing for the skis today.
Yeah, this is Norwegian team preparing their skis, making sure they're going to get the best speed from them in the terrain. But yes, we have 55 men, and we will be looking to probably some of the Norwegians to set some fast times that we can use to check everyone's progress through the forest. Of course, the preparation is very crucial so that the athletes can get the best skiing from the skis that they have, this World Ski Orienteering Championships.
Yesterday was much warmer. Today we have actually a little bit colder weather and icier and harder tracks. So the waxing isn't as crucial as it was yesterday. Sweden had really great skis. Today the differences between skis and waxing is are smaller. And first starter coming here is Markus Hallik from Estonia, and he's actually world champion in mountain bike orienteering, but he's been doing ski orienteering in many world championships.
Yep, he's been ski orienteering from at least 2002. And the 38-year-old taking 41st in the sprint at the Europeans and 27th in the sprint in 2015.
And men will be more aggressive in their skiing and tend to go more straight. And here we have Norway and Øyvind Wiggen, who will be probably setting the first times and the pace for the race. And as we saw from women's race, the conditions are really good, so it will be very fast race for men as well. Probably on the lower side, 12, 13 minutes.
Yep, they're not going to be in the forest for very long, and they're going to be following some of the routes that the women took, but mostly different controls, as we can see how they put the mat board on, strapped over their shoulders.
And some of the small route choices, especially in the end of the race, will be really important in deciding the medals and who will be the medalist in the race. All in all, there will be 14 controls in men's race, and the climbing for the race is 110 meters, so it's physically quite hard.
Yeah, a lot more climb. They've got a climb of about 40 meters, which is going to be all poling up to control number 3 on the very small tracks, quite near the beginning of the course, and I think that's going to show the ones who have the most power and the most technique of getting up that hill. So we'll be able to see that quite early on as we get the first radio timing from control number 7.
And especially in the end, there is about 35 meter climb from the fourth last control to the third last control, and there whether a athlete is really good in good condition will be quite decisive, because you can win if you are tired. You lose easily 10-15 seconds only on a relatively short stretch of the
and even coming up to control 12, the one we're talking about, they've got a long uphill from control number 10. There's a long uphill. They're going to be very, very tired. They've got to make some crucial decisions there, which is going to cost them time in the overall race, as we saw in the women's. So they'll be very, very tired at the end of the race, having pushed very, very hard over the short distance at the beginning. So I think it's going to all come down to the end of the race. But here's our fourth starter, Andrei Gerasimov.
From Lithuania. Lithuania has quite even team here. Lithuania is not ranked as the absolute top nations, but sometimes their racers have been making surprises and been fighting for the places in top 10.
Let's see if any of them can do that today.
And another Norwegian, Bjørnar Kvåle, and he's also one of those we expect to set the pace for the race in the early stages.
Yep, he raced yesterday in the mixed sprint relay, so he knows the terrain very, very well. He'll know what the tracks look like out there in the forest, and will be, I'm sure, pushing for the top times going around the course.
Shotaro Kishi from Japan.
Now, Shotaro Kishi learned to ski by watching YouTube videos. Now you know, but how's his technique? Not too bad?
No.
Better than mine?
Absolutely. And I'm sorry to laugh.
That's fine. You saw me skiing. It was bad. I've only skied once, but that's okay.
I don't think he will be falling quite so many times than you will. Japan has actually had a good team, and they organized the World Championships back in 2009 in Hokkaido. Excellent races, and Japan was their best skier, who is unfortunately not here, Morihiro. He's been fighting among the 20-25 best in World Championships, so...
Yeah, so you shouldn't count them out?
No, not in the top positions, but fighting fairly within the crowd.
Yeah.
The first of the Czechs, Michal Argalas. And you can see the athletes want to make sure by reading the map that they're doing the right route choices in the beginning, because it's, as you said a little bit earlier, it's really important to start well, not making mistakes and not stressing because of that.
Yes, if you find the first control spot on, it gives you a lot of confidence, I think, to go and really attack the rest of the course. And They're taking their time to properly look at the map on this first bit out of the arena as they cross the road. There's been a load of snow piled up over the road so they can get across there safely through the fence and out into the actual forest. But they will have made a lot of decisions about where they're going to go. And the route choice to number one, as we saw in the women's race, Tove Alexanderson taking a really good route to number one and actually taking a lot of time out of the others. So
yeah, she was almost 10 seconds faster to the first control than the others, and she won the gold medal with 8 seconds. So
yes, exactly. It could go down just to one route choice, and number one certainly requires a route choice. That was Takumi Ishihara, who we saw there, and some GPS tracking.
Yes, and you see Markus Hallik there is soon approaching the first radio time, so we know how much time it will take there. And you also see the two route choices going more straight with the narrow tracks, or then turning to right and using the wide tracks and speeder skiing towards the first control. Second Kazakhstani skier Azad Nazarov. Kazakhstan, as said, has the best ski orienteering team in Asia, and they've been doing stable performances in previous world championships. And for instance, in Norway, in sprint relay, they were on fifth position.
Yeah, and they've also got a big team as well. They've got lots of athletes, lots of skiers out there, which is really good to see them all probably trying to push each other as a group to get better and better. But here's one of the early Norwegians starting, Øyvind Wiggen.
Yes, and we expect him to be the one to set us the first pace for the races. And the athletes get the map 15 seconds before to put it in the map holder, and then basically making decisions of the first route choices to the first control.
So here we can see Markus Hallik still in the lead, taking the time to go up that. There we go. There he is. He's got this steep uphill. There is a lot of climb on this course for such a short distance, and this was a slope that we saw a lot of the women coming up earlier. It's much steeper than this camera angle makes it look, and they're going to be turning left into one of the tracks up here. We'll really be able to see the skiers' technique as they go and push up this hill, but then they can turn left into a track here and punch the control. And this point we'll get our first TV split, so we can have the first indication of just how fast they're doing. Now there's a little bit of a delay on this, so we will get their time
about 8:50. And as you remember, the women, it took 5:40 something for Tove Alexanderson to get there, and the men are actually doing longer distance and much, much more climbing in the beginning of the race, whereas the rest of the race is more like very similar to women's.
So actually, Markus Hallik and Zoltan Slep taking. Is that going to be the quickest route to those very short controls? But they're going a lot of downhill as they're taking the route on the right.
Yeah. Going from the right looks easier, and it's orienteering-wise easier, but physically they need to then climb on a narrow track in quite deep snow up, and it's also sudden slope.
Do you think they're also taking that to make sure they're skiing through the control rather than having to turn around?
We made a test. I took the route from the right, and I lost about 10 seconds. Instead of going straight up from the left side.
Yeah, because there was more climb overall. Arsen Zhuravel from Ukraine just getting out of his skis after the warm-up so he can make his way to the start. And we can see big line of the starters. But this is Ilmar Udam from Estonia, the second Estonian out on the course today. He is ranked number 51 in the world, and 15 seconds before his start, he's got the map. Can already start to see the route to number one and orientate the map correctly. So he's going to be heading east out of the start. There's a little bit of track as they go out of the arena, cross the road, and then head behind the biathlon centre through the fence and into the terrain. You can see he's holding the map, keeping it steady as he can focus on that, possibly for maybe for a bit too long. He wasn't quite prepared for that little slope there.
It's rather difficult actually to ski and read the map. And you have uneven surface on the track, so it really requires good coordination and practice to ski well on narrow tracks.
Andrei Gerasimov from Lithuania.
And he is going approximately the same speed as Markus Hallik.
Yeah, possibly slightly behind, possibly about 10 seconds behind. But
somehow it seems that we don't get the intermediate times here on the TV screen.
I think you are right. We've got on our computer, we've got Andrei Gerasimov punching that control in a time of 8:55. And the next person we should be seeing through at our first split is Michal Argelas from Czech Republic. He was a sixth starter, so he looks like he's caught up a lot of time on Jan Segielka from Poland and some of the others as well. But looks to be going fairly well. Now here we can see number 14, Denis Vlasov from Kazakhstan. 15 seconds before he will take the start and go out into the forest. Now he has a fair bit of experience skiing in at least three world championships before, so he knows what the system is like, what the procedure is, and how he can do well. This is number six. This is Michal Argelas looking to
take the lead.
Yep. Looking to be similar to the time of Andrei Gerasimov, who currently, I think, is possibly in second place. We hadn't got the time from Margus Halleck of Estonia through, but he's now punched our pre-warning of our second TV control, so we may see him coming up through the arena and into the second TV control soon.
And as you see, after punching control, you have to read map and make your route choices, and you are moving all the time, and the next crossing is coming in a few seconds, and you have to decide, do you continue or do you turn right? It looks easy in TV, it looks very easy in theory, but doing it in full speed, it's
another problem. It's very easy to for us to state, I think, sitting here commentating, for us to criticize the athletes that we're looking at, make an assessment of how well they're doing. But we know that they're going to be moving through the forest, speeds of up to 50-60 kilometers an hour. And that's, I think, a speed that everything is going to be flashing past you very, very quickly. You'll have tracks, decision-making points coming up every 5-10 seconds. And you've always got to have a decision. Yeah, and uneven terrain, everything's going to make it
reading,
very difficult.
Reading maps. So
yes.
In average, when we look at dense track network in ski orienteering, you have to make decisions about every 10 seconds.
Yeah. And you've got to be two or three decisions ahead, so you know you're not going to hesitate at any of them. You know, it's going to be a left, right, exactly.
Straight.
Yeah.
So
here's from Japan, it's Shotaro Kishi coming up the hill to our first TV split. He looks like he's quite a way down on the lead. Yep, about 2 minutes down on the time of Marcus Halleck and Michelle Argelas, who are the current leads. This is Klaus Schuss.
From Romania, Klaus been many years in World Cup and World Championships, and I think his best World Cup position was 11th. So he's been regularly among the 25 best, 25th.
How much does experience count in this race, as we see someone making an interesting route choice going the other way? David Cormet, who's actually taking the quickest time there, but this is Michel Argelas.
No, it's Oeyvind Wiggen who's now taking the lead. I don't think David's time, it can't be right.
We haven't seen him through the pre-warning
faster.
Control, no.
So Oeyvind Wiggen takes the lead.
It's actually David Cormet's birthday today, so happy 22nd birthday. Hopefully he will have a good race and realise if he has made a mistake there going through the control.
Hopefully not.
Hopefully not.
Arsen Zurabel from Ukraine, and he's one of the more experienced ones. Arsen has been fighting for places between 10 and 20 in earlier races, and here we have Marcus Halleck as a first starter coming to finish.
The first finisher as well. Pretty good race for him then to be the first starter and the first finisher, getting set the fastest time, yep. The time to beat for the rest of them.
And given his time here, I think he hasn't made big mistakes there during the route, but the top guys will go 3-4 minutes faster.
Yeah, but you'll see that time fall and fall as we go throughout the race. For this is another Norwegian. This is Bjørnar Kvale, who was racing in the sprint relay yesterday. Looking very quick there.
Yes, and brought Norway to fourth position yesterday, and he's very young in a sport actually where experience counts quite a lot. For instance, Erik Rost has been in top positions in European Championships, World Cup for many, many years. I think for 8 years, been fighting for the top. And yesterday he got his first World Championships medal.
This is our second TV control.
Andrei Gerasimov, and he is about 8 seconds behind Marcus Halleck. And he took the right route choice to the second last control there.
Yep, the one that goes fairly straight on out of that control looks like the quickest. This is Roland Fesselhofer. Now, he was telling me yesterday that he lives in Austria and has to travel 2 hours out to somewhere where he can do ski orienteering every weekend. So he only gets to ski at the weekend because of where he lives, but tries to make the most of all the opportunities he can to actually get out and train. But a two-hour drive is, I think it's quite a long way to go. But if you love ski orienteering and you want to train, then you'll go as far as you have to go.
Yeah. And there we have Ilmar Udam. Yes, they've corrected the intermediate times.
Yep.
So Oeyvind Wiggen, as we were expecting, he has taken the lead, 8:22.
Yep, that's a 25-second lead after only 1.5 kilometres of this 3.5-kilometre course. So only a third of the way through, but already a 25-second lead,
yeah.
Clear lead. And Ilmar Udam looks to be dropping down the orders as he decides to turn round and head to this control.
And that might be a mistake, because he's then choosing to run on the wide tracks, which are fast and easier easier to ski, but you are gathering too much distance, extra distance due to that.
Yeah, and you still have to go a bit uphill. He's not doing it. He's probably doing it to avoid some of the climb, but it's probably not going to be useful overall. But Andrei Karasimov coming in for second place, our second finisher today. Not quite taking the time of Margus Halleck.
And we have Takumi Ishihara, who is the third of the Japanese here. Japan has three competitors here, and Takumi's brother, Yuki, is also here, and he's started a little bit earlier.
Yep. Out in the forest, Petr Horvat, Czech Republic.
Probably made a mistake because he is now returning to a control, so he's probably checked the map wrong and had to then go back to the controls. He's missed something, and now he's coming right up to the radio control.
Yeah.
Øyvind Wiggen still in lead, but Petr Horvat is actually taking now the first position.
Yep, he looks like he's got about 15 seconds before the time of Øyvind Wiggen goes out, but he's fairly close, looking good, and he's in a group there. Is it quite difficult to pass people when they all group up like that?
Yes, especially on the narrow tracks. On the other hand, except perhaps for relay, the orienteers are rather polite. They know if if there is somebody who is much better coming from behind. And now we have Øyvind Wiggen being on the second radio control, going to now do the second last control and trying to check his route choice.
Yep, and his time looks good. It looks like a good time for him.
He's in clear lead, and let's see. He decides to turn back and win time. That is actually a couple of seconds faster towards the last control.
Yeah, it was a minute faster than Michel Argelas, who's our current leader. So we will see him into the finish soon, looking to be posting a very good time for the start. He's going to be setting the times to beat at the finish.
And there we have Klaus Schuss coming to the first radio, starting to climb the steep hill, and he's done very well at this stage, and he's likely to take the lead.
Yeah, I think you could be right there. It's going to be very close to Petr Horvat's time as they all go up this very steep hill, take the left turn into our first radio control. But into the finish.
That is Øyvind Wiggen, and he takes the lead with almost a minute.
That's a good chunk of time taken out there.
I think the next Norwegian, Bjørnar Kvåle, will be the one to challenge him, unless Petr Horvat from Czech comes the second half of the race as well as he did in the beginning.
Yep, as we move further down the start list, Dmitry Adamovich.
Less known of the Kazakhs in the team. I think this is his he's been in the World Championships 2013 when they were actually running Kazakhstan, so in his second World Championships.
Yep, he's raced in Russia already this season, so he'll be familiar with the starting system and Russian terrain. Back out into the forest, we were just talking about him, it's Bjørnar Kvåle.
Yes, he's coming in and he's taking a clear lead from Klaus Schuss.
Oh, yeah.
He's probably 40 seconds, more than 40 seconds ahead of Klaus Schuss. And
about a minute ahead of his teammate,
Øyvind Wiggen. And as you can hear from Vitalius Petrius, it is a very steep hill. You have to climb to the second radio control, and then in rather tough downhill, you have to decide your route choice to the next control.
Yeah, you've got to, but while navigating the technical track, you've got to be picking up speed going that downhill. You've got to make sure you see his hands on the map, making sure it's orientated properly and choosing the correct route on something that could be a matter of 5 seconds, but 5 seconds could be very important.
Evan Thomas from Estonia has been doing good races during the years, and will be fighting for a place among the 15 best. And we are now getting the higher ranked starters soon. Asad Nasirov currently way behind. Here we have the young Italian.
Yep.
Davide Comai, the birthday birthday boy, but he's also lost in the race, coming to finish and now on the fifth position among the starters. And Vitalius Petrus.
Yep, round the corner into the final finishing straight. We saw him giving all the efforts going up that hill, and then it's quite a steep uphill again into the arena, but third position there. So far, about 14 seconds down on the current lead.
Next starter here from Romania, Simeon Suciu, and very soon we will have the 20 best ranked athletes coming up, starting from Tuomas Kotro from Finland, starting with number 36.
But our 26th starter out of 55. Making sure he gets a hasty start out of the gate, build up some speed and check the map quickly before this little bank out into the forest. But this coming up, probably what we think is a slower route. It's a lot of poling. About 35 metres up that is Petr Horvat, but not challenging the time of Øyvind Wiggen.
Horvat was on the first radio. He was ahead of Øyvind Wiggen, but now he's behind. And with that route choice, going straight and losing time again, going straight on a narrow track on double poling, you lose 5 to 10 seconds only in a very short distance. So bad route choice from Peter. Otherwise, he's been doing a good race so far.
Yeah, but with that speed coming down the hill onto the wider track, it's very tricky, and you've got to make sure you retain your balance, and that's something we haven't seen before.
No.
Good idea.
Not for the control point.
No.
But for Peter, yes, he turned his skis very quickly.
Didn't lose very much time. Here we can see Øyvind Wiggen and Petr Horvat. We can see Petr Horvat having a much better first start of the race. They're both taking the same route choice to number two, which we think is the slower of the route choices. Having a lot of power to get up the hill, and the GPS, I think, just looking slightly different on there, but that doesn't seem to be anything to worry about. And this was a...
Øyvind made a mistake and he lost time. But he's catching up here.
I don't think Øyvind lost too much time on that control, actually going around the top on the better track and then approaching it from the top. But here we can see Øyvind probably just skiing a bit faster and taking the speed through the controls, I think.
Yeah, and Peter Horvat coming and losing about 20 seconds to Øyvind Wiggen there in the end.
Yeah, I think just not quite having the speed over the last part of the course, and of course losing a little bit of time up into control 12, where we saw him coming up that hill, which is a lot of double poling right at the very end of the race.
And falling in a crossing there.
Yeah.
Still good race.
So back out at the first radio control. Looks like
Francesco Corradini.
Yep, he raced the sprint relay yesterday. The brother
of Stefania and a son of Niccolo, the former world champion.
It's also his first senior competition.
And he's still a junior.
Yep, he's still a junior. He raced at the junior world champs this year, finishing 32nd in the sprint.
Very likely we will get the new leader, Bjørnar Kvåle, coming in. He's in clear lead. And coming now to the second last control. Let's see what's his route choice then to the last control.
Yeah, we've already had his time at control number 12, and it looks to be very good compared to Wiggen.
And you can see here all the men, they turn back actually very quickly.
Yeah.
And choose the faster route choice, whereas among others, Tove Alexandersson
choosing to go through that control. But here we can see the lead of Bjørnar Kvåle going through and over a minute in the lead at our second radio control, and that's looking like a lot of time taken out of the rest of the field there. He's going to be setting a great time for the Norwegian team, and this is how we can see just how far ahead he was of all the rest.
Yeah, and he is coming to the finish. And I think he's fighting for a place among the 10 best.
Yes. Lost a bit of time going into control 12, but looking very strong going around this fairly sharp corner. It's a complete 180, but pushing all the way to the end to take the new fastest time. Pushing all the way to the line, because we know that the seconds and even the milliseconds can count. That's a great new fastest time, as he's being chased.
And we have Klaus Schuss here. He started well in the competition and now fighting for fourth position.
Yep, it looks like he's going to split some of the Czech athletes there, finishing. He was caught.
Caught by Bjørnar Kvåle for 2 minutes.
Yep.
So Bjørnar Kvåle, done an excellent race so far in the race, in the competition. And I think his time will last quite long today.
He'll be having a nervous wait to see where he ends up as everyone comes in slightly faster. As we see one of the Japanese runners in front of us coming into the finish. It's Yuki Ishihara, but out in the start gates, the last of our runners before we go into the seeded starts, into the red group, the ones at the top of the rankings, is Igor Zvontsov. He also skied yesterday in the sprint relay.
He's very experienced, been in ski orienteering for a long time.
Yep, there are two athletes skiing here who are both 54, and Igor ran the M50 at the World Masters this year, which were in Finland. Also does a bit of mountain biking as well. I think that the skills that you need for both mountain bike orienteering and ski orienteering are very transferable. It's all about tracks and planning ahead of the junctions and being able to have the similar navigation, I think. Yeah. But back out in the forest. Check.
One of the strong Czechs, Jakub Skuda, coming here, and he's also making a quite good intermediate time, but far behind Bjørnar Kvåle, who's apparently started very well in the first part of the race, and he finished also very strong.
Yep, looks like he'll be in the first in the top two or three positions at the first intermediate control, but not challenging the time of the Norwegian. And behind him
is Even Thomas, but he's quite far behind now in the race.
So will the skiers think about, know who's gone before them and know how many minutes they've caught up when they catch somebody? Some of them will choose to look at the start list, and some will probably not really want to think about it and think focus on their own race, I guess.
Yes, especially in the top group. They will look at, okay, where will I start? And if the fact is that if in sprint somebody makes... Oh.
Yes, looks like Even Thomas completely missed the track turning there and was being followed and just has just gone completely off the map, having to realise that fairly quickly and turn around. But that's quite a lot of time that he lost there. As you see, another one of the Norwegian start. This is Øyvind Vatedal.
And Øyvind he's one of the strongest in the pack, and he's been really focusing on getting to medals here. He's been in top 10 before, and he even came here to have a training camp within the region to know the conditions.
Yep, so very well prepared. As we see, the 38th starter, John Schneider. Now, he didn't race at the Europeans. He was out with a knee injury. Well, had some good form, but lost a bit of time of training because of this injury. So we'll see how that affects him out in the forest, possibly not having the strength that he would have hoped to this point in the season.
He's very fast skier in the forest, and he's known to give everything.
Yes, he won't let any injury hold him back.
No. And he was training a little bit too much for the previous world champs and basically couldn't race.
Basically overtrained, yeah.
Overtrained and couldn't race. And he's not been... That was a very big disappointment for him, but he's coming back now and can actually do good races if he has a good day.
That was Sandro Trudman coming out of control number 6. You can see the big valley behind him. He's got to go down and back up again, and we're going to soon find him at the radio control number 1, which is control 7 on the map. But one of the Russians, this is the first of the Russians,
Vladimir Barchukov. He's one of the most experienced. He's been medalist in world championships, but never won gold. And he's originally here from Krasnoyarsk. So I think Vladimir is now focusing and only on getting that missing medal of gold.
Yep. Sandro Trudman going in a good time, challenging Bjørn Kvale. Not quite as close, probably about 10 seconds behind, but that's the closest we've seen anybody get so far. We will keep an eye on him. Some of the red group starting to challenge the lead of the Norwegian. As we see, Yuri Usitalo.
Yes, he is probably one of the strongest Finns today. He's very good skier and still very young in the sport. And he's one of those who can actually make a surprise and do extremely well if everything goes to plan.
Francesco Corradini coming into the finish. Looks like he's going to take 8th place.
Not bad performance for a junior.
Yep, his first senior competition. But back in the forest. This is Norris Breitzer from Latvia. He's not going to challenge the top 2 places, but not a bad time.
Nope.
Not a bad time. Pushing under 8 minutes, I think, is pretty good at this point of the race. Let's see if he can keep it up and maybe take some time out of Bjørn Kvåle's possibly slower route choice going up into our second TV split.
And here we have Raivo Kivleniecz, one of the guys who can actually surprise. He has a potential to be among top 15 today.
This and is someone just...
Just broke his ski. That's Aslan Tokbayev. Aslan Tokbayev of Kazakhstan, who's unfortunately broken his ski. And in sprint...
That's it.
Yep.
So he'll probably just walk around the rest of the course. There's only one more control left.
Yeah.
Punch
and
it.
Again, the ski orienteers, they want to finish. They don't want to give up.
Yes.
Another one who's been many time world medalist was Kirill Veselov earlier, missing the individual gold. And another surprise name today, Mattis Jaama from Estonia. He was fifth in the European Championships just a month ago.
And also raced yesterday. Here we are going up this hill after our second TV split.
And Jakub Skoda. But he is now behind Björn Kvåle, and we are very soon waiting for Sandra Trutman, who was who is probably the first one who is seriously challenging Björn Kvåle. We can see the different route choices, three different route choices already to the first control, and
Even to the third control, that's a lot of difference. Skoda probably taking the better route to two, but then going through the control and losing time to control number three. Number 43.
Tero Linnanmaa, one of the younger Finns on his second World Championships, hasn't been this year at his best. His father was in the World Championships in the 1990s, so second generation skier in here.
Well, we can see number 46, Filip Terisaarela, who skied yesterday, but back in the forest. This is Oyvind Rattedal.
And he's going to take the lead.
He is going to take the lead. He's got a way to go up this hill yet, but it looks like his time is good. Going to challenge a Norwegian, going to knock another Norwegian off the top spot, but again they're grouping up quite a lot here as they can use this wide slope to overtake.
And Owen's going to take a lead with more than 15 seconds, and he's already almost caught Tuomas Kotro from Finland for 1 minute, so very good start for Øyvind Vatterdal.
Number 44 is Yuri Yaziko
from Belarus, and after him are the big favorites starting one after another. And here we have Kirill Veselov, many time world champion in relay as well as medalist in individual distances, but never world champion individually. Also his hometown Krasnoyarsk.
Yep, he'll be having a home crowd to cheer him on, and knows this is an important race. But number 28 is Jakub Skoda, finishing
second position so far in the race. Sergei Gorlanov, a younger Russian in the team, and he did extremely well in the European Championships. If I remember correctly, he took silver medal.
He took bronze medal
in the sprint.
So he's got some good sprint form this season. Number 49, Lars Moholt.
One of the favorites today. Extremely strong skier. And then we have Vladimir Barchukov coming here towards the first radio.
Yeah, this is control number six. He's got seeing a lot of double poling out there, and it's gonna go down this slope in this re-entrant and then keep climbing more up into the control. This is where there's a big track that they can use to climb up the hill almost to the top of the area before they've got a very long control into number eight, and they're gonna be thinking about that route choice. We've seen one interesting route choice already so far through there, but and into the top 10. the top starters, the top 10 ranked in the world, but their order is random within that top 10. So any the medal could come from one of those.
Yes, Sandra Trutmann from Switzerland, he came there and he was very close, Bjarne Kvåle, on first radio, but now he's lost a lot of time to Bjarnar on the second half of the race.
Yeah, he lost at least a minute, I think, just on that small section of the race, so doesn't seem like he's going to be challenging the lead of the Norwegian at the moment.
Andrei Grigoriev, the third racer from Krasnoyarsk area, he is a world champion from 2011 on long distance, where there was a really hard duel between Finland, Staffan Tunis, and Andrei Grigoriev. Most of the race there were just few seconds from each other, and then it came to the sprint finish in the end.
Norris Reitzer
from
Latvia, about a minute and a quarter down. He is making sure to look very carefully at the map there to get the right track heading into the second to last control. This is where we saw Petter Horvat fall earlier, making sure he takes the right route choice, which we think he has done. That looks like it's the quickest.
And Sandra Trutmann coming in. He was very close, Bjarne Kvåle, in the beginning, but now he has lost quite a lot of time in the end.
Yep, it's going to be a minute and a half behind Bjarne Kvåle. And dropping into fourth place. Looks like he's going to just take it ahead of Sulcis, the Lithuanian.
The sprint race is rather physical, and although you don't see directly from the map, it's up and down all the time on the slope. And from 10th to 12th control, you actually climb 40, 45 metres.
Yes, it's a lot of climb at the end, but there's a lot more climb than on the women's course. They're going up and down these hills all the time, and then let's see one of the last starters.
Andrei Lamov, who was there, he's the reigning world champion in a sprint. And another reigning world champion from long distance, Lars Moholt from Norway. And Lars was excellent last year. He won all the individual distances in the European Championships.
Yep, and he's currently first in the world rankings. Good all-rounder, and you can see that just from the speed he gets from the start.
Lars was also in the junior champion of Norway in cross-country before he decided to go into ski orienteering. So there is no...
A strong speed background there,
exactly.
Added to the navigation.
And following Lars, Andrei Grigoriev. Home crowd.
Yep, and just a minute between each of the starters means that they're going to be all out in the forest together at the end. We will see, probably not at the end where they're all more equally matched, but we've seen a lot of people catch each other up, and just 15 seconds to put the map in the map holder and check out some of the routes there. You can see Grigoriev trying to decide his route to number one so that he can put the maximum concentration on the acceleration out of the start. But Linnema into the first radio point at 1.5, and he goes into second place.
Extremely good start from Tero Linnema. And he's basically chasing there Mattis Jama, 1 minute. And Oive Vatteldar takes the lead, but with
With 0.2 of a second ahead of his teammate. This is going to be very, very,
very
close
tough
between the two of them. At the end, they've just got to go to two more controls, then up the hill into the arena. Oh, that could be very, very close on the line. We will keep an eye on that. But here is Marcus Lundholm for Sweden.
And Øyvind Vatterdal is climbing the hill towards the last control. and soon coming to the stadium, and they had 2/10 of the difference. Now Vatterdal is coming there. Bjarne Kåle has done excellent end, because he was clearly behind Vatterdal at the first radio, but now they are basically even, and there is Øyvind.
Yep, he's got a few seconds, 6 seconds to make it into the finish, or might be too late. I think he's going to not quite have the speed going up that hill, and no, he's going to go into second place. Norway 1-2 so far, only 2.3 seconds down, but losing 2 seconds on the final part of the course has cost him the new leading time. But Norway 1-2, it's looking good for the Norwegians at the moment.
It is. And I think this is Sergei Gorlano. And he's just coming in and doing actually a good radio time. And Vladimir Barchukov now on the second radio control, but it doesn't look good.
No, struggling. Oh, there we go.
He's lost the basket from his pole. That race is over.
It's bad news.
Bad news for Vladimir.
Probably struggling to get up that hill and maybe taking
awful.
The wrong route choice. A lot of the men are deciding probably to go straighter, thinking they've maybe got the power, as the women may be playing a
but still
bit
you,
safer.
You
but they've taken the wrong... Yeah. They're losing a lot of time there. And here we can see this is the champion from the sprint relay. This is Erik Rost, very experienced skier, and he knows exactly what the terrain's like. He knows it's fast out there, and let's see if he can take another medal today.
Ville-Petteri Saarela coming in, and he is doing very well, but he's probably slightly behind Sergei Gorlano. They are currently going about the same speed to the intermediate time. Erik Rost is manifold European champion, but he hasn't again. Oh, what a mistake.
Ooh, missing the track
missing
to get down.
Missing one control, and then you lose that much. And here we have Vladimir Barchukov coming in. But as you saw,
he
doesn't have a pole basket in his ski pole, and no matter how hard you try, you lose.
Oof. He certainly was trying very hard, but his race
everything.
Is over at that point, especially when you need the high speeds for the sprint.
Very sad. Mm. Most important race of the year, and then you lose your basket, and you lose only 26 seconds. Going that uphill, as you saw, it's awful.
Well, yes, you lose just, 10, 15 seconds just going on that uphill bit, and then missing the basket is just another problem, and hitting the deck at the end of that race.
What a disappointment. And Kirill Veselo, another Krasnoyarsk guy, and then we have
our last starter
Ulrik Nordberg from Sweden, and he's one of those who can actually win. He has it in his very, very skillful with skis. He's the one who do basically the freestyle stuff on normal skis. And Yuri Uusitalo
in fourth
fast
place
gear, but not enough today.
No, not enough to challenge the Norwegians. But this is Kirill Veselov out in the terrain,
and he's 12 seconds behind Øyvind Vatterdal, so it's still double Norwegian in the top. Double Norwegian in the top of the race. And I think Yuri Uusitalo was expecting more today. And Lars Moholt, the world ranking number one, coming to the first radio. Will it be then threefold Norwegian?
Bjørnar Kvåle was... No, he's behind.
So Øyvind Vatterdal still leading, and Lars is about 20 seconds behind. That was a surprise. Øyvind Vatterdal has started really, really hard.
Started very, very well.
But Bjørnar Kvåle was much, much faster in the end.
Yeah, in the end. So it still shows he's not too far behind Bjørnar Kvåle's time. Could make some time up at the end of the race, but not matching the fastest ones at the moment.
Absolutely not. So Bjørnar Kvåle's finish was really, really fast. And now we have the Latvian driver Kivlenieks coming in. And he's done also a good race. However, not fighting for the medals today.
Nope. Still quite a long way. A minute and a half, minute 24 down on our current leader. It's still fairly wide grouping at this point.
Yes.
Wide spacing, people coming in at this point in the race. But we see one of the Finns also coming in front of us, but back out into the forest.
And Andrei Grigoriev coming to the next control.
But he's already down on the leading times. He's already slower than all of the Norwegians.
Yes. Norway has been starting really, really fast, and there we get Gorlanov coming now to the second last control, and he is now in the lead. And Tero Linnaima, also from Finland, has been doing extremely well.
And whilst we were focusing.
0.3 seconds behind Gorlano. Veselov has been strong in the end as well. But for Kirill, no individual cold today either.
No, but Russia 1-2. Russia 1-2. And then
and Lamov
Sweden,
still coming.
Hammerberg. But Lamov's still coming. He looks like he was posting a fast time as well. But 1-2, Russia. Can it be 1-2-3? This is Norwegian. This is Lars Moholt making the right decision to turn back on the track. It's slightly quicker, about 5 seconds, and then can carry the speed through as he takes the left-hand junction after this one. But taking the, what we think is the correct route up here, it's the Russian, it's Andrei Grigoriev, and taking a very fast route.
He's behind. Moholt was behind and Grigoriev was behind. So Gorlanov looks very good. Veselov was only 1.3 seconds behind. And now we have Lars Moholt coming to the finish, the reigning world champion in long distance, but not fast enough today.
No, not quite fast enough to challenge the two Russians who are leading. But
still fighting for place among the 10 best.
And Lars Moholt slotting into 8th place there.
And he was showing his pole again also.
But the time so far at the finish, Sergei Gorlanov in first place, currently only 1.3 seconds ahead of Kirill Veselov, Russia top two, but Martin Hammerberg taking third place currently for Sweden. As we look down, Jakub Skoda, 1 minute 50 behind the leaders, but this looks like it's going to be another Russian.
That's Andrei Grigoriev, and you can hear from the crowd, they're cheering their... No, it's Andrei Lamov, and he's...
No, it's 50. No. It is Grigoriev. It's not the
it's
time
Grigoriev.
Of Lamov on the screen. It's Grigoriev wearing
yes,
the number 50. He's going to be a bit late, I think, on the time.
Yep. Now
there
they corrected the ninth position. But Lamov
position
should be
Grigoriev.
Coming if he still wants to win.
Yep, we will be watching for Lamov, who will be climbing his way. There we go, there he is.
There he
just
is.
Just gone out of control, number 13, and is going to be going down a wide track before climbing up into the arena. I think the whole arena is going to be waiting for Andrei Lamov now. He was very quick by a wide margin at the beginning of this course, and this is him. Catching up Marcus Lundholm,
Marcus
a minute Lundholm. Already. That will give him a lot of confidence heading into this final sprint for the finish line. He's got someone to push him all the way to the end, but it's Andrei Lamov.
And it's not a lot of time, but he will take the lead at this stage.
It's looking good for Lamov as he takes this bend, making sure he can get rounded in the space provided. And
15
into the finish.
Seconds left.
It's looking brilliant for Andrei Lamov. And taking the lead.
With 11 seconds.
11 seconds. That is, looks like a good time.
He started very fast, but then Gorlano was fast in the second half. And this was much stronger Andrei Lamov than we saw yesterday.
Yeah, I would agree with that. He looks to have taken a lot of time out of the Russians. So Russia 1-2-3. We've still got
Eric Gross,
Stanimir Baramajev and Ulrich Nordberg left out in the forest. Just three left to go.
And the time goes out for Eric Gross now.
Yep, looks like Eric Gross is going to be a bit late. Can we see where he's been pre-warned? We've seen him at the TV control in 12:41, which is down.
And there
on the
comes
time
Eric Gross.
It looks like he's going to be down on the time of Lamov. Not quite the gold medal of yesterday, but can still push for some of the top places. No, out of the medals already. Not quite got the speed today. into, looks like he's going to just pip his teammate Martin Hammerberg into
fourth place. At this stage, we have Belomarshev and Norberg left. Otherwise, it will be triple Russian.
Yep, it looks like we saw Norberg is probably the most likely of those two to challenge the medals, do you think?
And Belomarshev should come now if he's to fight for the medals.
But there's no sign of him yet in the arena. You can see him coming up the steep slope. He's too late to challenge the medals, we think. Taking the punch through the control, not losing any speed.
Now the time went out for Lamov and Gorlanov and Veselov, but good race from Stanimir. I know he's been focusing to get medal, and in good day he can win gold, but not today.
Not today, maybe in some of the races later in this week, the middle or the long distance.
Now we have only Ulrich Nordberg left. He was the closest and he is fighting for a medal.
He is in the arena. He's just got a short way to go, 100 metres or so, a couple of hundred metres, rounding the corner, and it's going to be close.
Or silver.
It's very close for Nordberg. Is he going to split the Russians?
It's basically the same time. Let's see. Yes, he did. It's gold for Sweden.
Gold for Sweden on the line. We couldn't tell it by the line, but it is 1.6 seconds, that lead. And the last starter, you said he could challenge for the medal. You said he was one of the ones, if he got it right on the day, he could push all the way. And Sweden have just taken it from the Russians.
Second gold.
Wow.
He was a little bit behind Lamo in the first half of the race, but then was able to speed up, and actually the crowd isn't as happy as they were with the triple lead.
I think you've hit the nail on the head there. That is exactly right. But he is absolutely delighted to do that, taking the Russians and beating them on their home soil, especially with so many Russians from Krasnoyarsk. That is a great result from Ulrich Nordberg, and you can see he's taken the win just 1.6 seconds ahead of Andrei Lamov, who looked to be doing very, very well. He had taken a lot of gap out of the other Russians and the Norwegians and the Swedes. Sergei Gorlanov, into third place, 13.5 seconds behind. And then Øyvind Vatterdal in 11th, Lars Moholt in 13th, and then some of the others taking up some of the later positions, up to 1 and 2 minutes, 3 minutes behind. Some people will be pleased getting a top 20. Others probably racing their teammates into the lead, even Tumas in 35th.
After the big, big mistake, missing one turn, and then you get out of the map, and then you have to come back when you realize that later. It's tough.
It is.
That was a very close race between Nordberg and Lamo.
But this was the winner rounding the corner, and that was a great win. He could probably feel the intensity of the Russians, knowing he was very, very close. And then when he realized he got it, just trying to look up and find out, we were waiting on Ten Hooks to finding when
Eric
he's got
Frost
it.
And coming then, yes, to congratulate.
Yep, the two gold medalists.
Here we see the GPS.
So the ones taking the northernmost route, they're thinking it's probably the quickest.
That's a lot. Lamov
looking
in the lead
in the beginning of the course, looking very, very quick and taking some good route choices with Veselov just behind. So let's see where we can find Ulrich Nordberg
starting to catch up. Behind. There was a small mistake.
Possibly a mistake from Lamov.
And Lamov still ahead, but getting tired, and now tie with Nordberg. And Nordberg's
just gone ahead, just going out of control 12, and very, very close on the line. So possibly a mistake for Lamov into control 9. There are a lot of tracks around that area, and just probably trying to make the decision to run through the control there. But here was your third place,
Sergei Gorlano,
in the sprint race of these world championships in Krasnoyarsk. A fast time, but couldn't quite match those of the two who were very, very close at the lead. This is Andrei Lamov, who was very, very quick at the beginning of the course, but possibly a mistake to control 9, and then just not quite getting it at the end, going up the slower track to control 12. But this is your world champion. This is Ulrik Nordberg taking control 42 and having just had the speed, I think, at the end to edge it out over Lamov. Sweden take the win in the men's race as well as the women's. They have 3 golds out of 3 so far. It's a great world championships for Sweden, and they've raced very, very hard and very strongly these past 2 days. So the crowd will probably be a bit disappointed, but they've still got 2 medals they can cheer for, and 3 in the top 4, so that's a pretty mean achievement. Anyway, you can stay tuned. We're going to bring you the flower ceremony from this race. We'll feature the top 6 runners of both the women's and the men's results. We can celebrate their success. They'll be getting flowers and some prizes, but we will wait for the official results to be confirmed, and they'll be getting their medals later on. But the flower ceremony coming up.
We'll be right back. Дамы и господа, цветочная церемония награждения победителей и призеров 22-го чемпионата мира по лыжному ориентированию в дисциплине спринт женщины.
Ladies and gentlemen, the flower ceremony for the winner and medalists of the 22nd World Ski Orienteering Championships in the discipline of sprint women.
So we can take the flower ceremony for the women's race. Happened earlier this afternoon, Russia time. And the medals will be presented to the top six athletes, those on the podium.
The flowers and gifts are presented by
Сергей Георгиевич Беляев, президент Федерации спортивного ориентирования России.
Сергей Георгиевич Беляев, the president of the Sport Orienteering Federation of Russia.
И Сейджан Мельдебекович Кайпаков, президент Федерации спортивного ориентирования Республики Казахстан.
And Сайджан Мельдебекаев-Кабаков, the president of the Sport Orienteering Federation of the Republic of Kazakhstan.
За шестое место награждается...
Medals presented by the Kazakhstani and Russian ski orienteering presidents. And in sixth place,
Mirka
Suturi. Taking... sixth place, 1 minute and 3 seconds down on the time.
За пятое место награждается Мария Кечкина, Россия.
Мирка Ситари looks like she just edged out Linda Lindquist for sixth place. They were given the same finishing time of 14 minutes 57, but we can take it down to the tenth of the second. In fifth place, Maria Kachkina from Russia. Just a minute down on the lead. Had a very fast race. In fourth place,
Magdalena Olsen from Sweden.
The Swedish athlete Magdalena Olsen had a good race, but not quite as strong as the top three, receiving flowers and prizes. And then we meet the top three, the medalists from this women's sprint competition.
За третье место награждается Салла Коскела, Финляндия.
In third place, we award Салла Коскела.
So third place for Salla Koskela. All these three athletes in the top three, they all raced yesterday and got the same medal yesterday. Consistency, I think, in their skiing. But Salla Koskela is delighted with her third place. A good race. It's her first individual medal.
Polina Frolova from the Russian Federation.
Polina Frolova from Russia. She looked like she was close to challenging Tova Alexanderson at some point, but it was Tova Alexanderson who started in the first of the final group of athletes who had the lead the whole way round.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner, Tova Alexanderson from Sweden.
And the world champion, who gets another gold to add to her collection. Sweden, 3 golds out of 3 already in this championships. And another round of prizes for Tove Alexanderson, who was just magnificent out in the forest, was incredibly strong. She is just a class of her own, I think, and knows exactly how to ski very fast and has incredible navigation skills, as we've seen from her foot orienteering capabilities, also taking 2 golds in the World Orienteering Championships in Sweden in the summer. And there are your medalists.
will tell you after the men's race when
So the top six of the race. Celebrating their achievements in front of this Russian crowd that stayed to cheer them on.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's again congratulate all the winners and medalists again on this competition day.
And, but not too much celebrating, they have another race tomorrow. It will be the middle distance where these three will be looking to get more medals, I think. They are strong in all of the disciplines, but Tove Alexandersen with another gold in the sprint. This makes it four World Championships in a row. She has won gold in this competition. She seems to be unbeatable in this discipline, her best discipline, but a fourth gold in the World Ski Orienteering Championships sprint race. So next up, we will take a look at the men's top six as they are awarded their flowers and their basket of goods before they get their medals later on after all the results have been confirmed. Make sure there are no disagreements about the results. But doesn't it look like that's going to happen? We're going to celebrate their flowers and their achievements in front of the crowd at the arena at the Biathlon Centre.
Дамы и господа, через несколько минут состоится цветочная церемония награждения победителей и призеров 22-го чемпионата мира по лыжному ориентированию в дисциплине спринт мужчины.
Ladies and gentlemen, in a few minutes we will begin the flower ceremony for the winner and medalists of the 22nd World Ski Orienteering Championship in the discipline of sprint men.
Дамы и господа, цветочная церемония награждения победителей и призеров 22-го чемпионата мира по лыжному ориентированию в дисциплине спринт мужчины.
Ladies and gentlemen, the flower ceremony for the winner and medalist of the 22nd World Ski Orienteering Championship in the discipline of sprint men.
So now the flower ceremony. They'll get their flowers and their baskets of prizes for the men's race in the sprint competition. The top six on the podium here in Krasnoyarsk for the 2017 World Ski Orienteering Championships as they take their positions.
The flowers and gifts are presented by
Лехо Халдна, президент Международной федерации ориентирования.
Medals presented by the president of the International Orienteering Federation.
И Вера Егоровна Оськина, депутат законодательного собрания Красноярского края.
And Вера Егоровна Оськина, deputy of the Legislative Assembly of the Krasnoyarsk Territory.
За шестое место награждается Эрик Рост, Норвегия.
In sixth place, Eric Rost from Sweden. not quite as quick as and as powerful as yesterday's race, but still a podium position. He was still down and in the first half of the race, just not quite as quick as the others today.
In fifth place, we award Stanimir Belomajev, Bulgaria.
Belomajev just edging ahead of Eric Rost, the Bulgarian taking fifth place today.
За четвертое место награждается Кирилл Веселов, Россия.
In fourth place, we award Kirill Veselov, the Russian Federation.
And one of three Russians on the podium today, Kirill Veselov, just edged out of third place in a medal. It looked like at one point like it could be Russia 1-2-3, but not the case. Strong results with him 15 seconds behind the leader.
In third place, we award Sergei Gorlanov, the Russian Federation.
Third place and bronze medal for Sergei Gorlanov, 13 seconds behind the lead. Didn't seem to make any mistakes out in the forest there, but just possibly not as quick as the two men who have beaten him.
Andrei Lamov, Russia.
In second place, we award Andrei Lamov, the Russian Federation.
Second place, another silver medal for Andrei Lamov to go with his silver from the sprint relay. It was incredibly close between him and Ulrich Nordberg, but he had to wait for the last finisher to finish to find out he was just pipped to the post by 1.3 seconds. He was very, very quick at the beginning of the race, but probably lost out at the end.
Ulrich Nordberg, Sweden.
But the man who pushed it all the way to the end and was able to overtake the good start of Andrei Lamov, it's Ulrich Nordberg, the world champion and gold medalist in this sprint discipline. He was delighted to find out his results as he crossed the line and was congratulated by the sixth place Eric Ross. I think a sigh of relief there as well. He should be very pleased with his result and will be, no doubt. And there we go, the top three finishers of this sprint competition.
Congratulate all the winners and medalists again on this competition day.
So those are the competitions today. Two golds for Sweden, making it three in total out of the three possible golds so far in this championships. Will they carry it on? Well, you'll just have to keep watching. We've got the middle distance for the women coming up tomorrow, and the following day, the middle distance for the men. We've also got the long distance race and the sprint relay coming up, where we may well see many of these men on the podium again. A very, very fast race for the men at the end of the day. So tune in next time for the middle distance.
Среди женщин ждем зрителей уже с 14:00. Приглашаем вас.